What is your Mount Rushmore of comedy?
Richard Pryor, George Carlin, a guy named Chris Rush. He's since passed away, but he was a mentor, and he opened up a door for me of what comedy could be. This is his. I got this in my desk.
Nice.
That's awesome. Chris Rush was a. That's an old. This is a cassette, kids. Years ago, when the Pilgrims arrived, they
that's
had the
awesome
Walkman.
Chris Rush. That.
And for me, I got to split the two. Only I got to split between the three. The fourth position, I want to put A, B, and C. My dad, only because he was funny as me, and I just, it was an influence, but it's not a public influence, so that's just for me. The other two is Jackie Gleason and Jack Klugman. When I was a kid, you know, growing up in New York, 11 o'clock, Channel 11, The Odd Couple's on, 11:30, The Honeymooners. And you would sneak out of your room. Mom and dad would be downstairs watching TV. I would sneak into my parents' room, turn on the black and white set, listen to it. I was beyond the phone with my friend Jimmy, just as the opening credits of The Honeymoons would start, and so we could see who could guess the episode first. We could do it like that.
And that's awesome.
Giggle and go to bed. So not knowing that stuff came into my consciousness when I was a kid. I know when Pryor did. When I was a kid, we went to a party with my parents. You know, when you go to those parties with your parents and your mother gives you the warning in the car, like, now don't like act like an animal because your father does business with these people. You behave yourself. So they were down in the basement. They watched Richard Pryor live in concert, all the adults. And I was 12, maybe 11, 12. They all went up to have coffee. I went in, I rewound the VCR and I went, whoa. I didn't know I was going to be a comic down, but I knew this is important. Look what this man can do.
Right.
I mean, I said that out loud to nobody. And then my aunt gave me a couple of cassettes of Carlin, and that was it.
Awesome, man. Of all of your, this might be a difficult one, all your comedy special CDs and DVDs, which one is your favorite?
I like them all because I'm still getting residual money.
There you go.
I don't know if my opinion is going to stop that passive flow, but in this pandemic, I need the cash, so I abstain from answering. I will tell you that in one of my specials I did called Funny as Hell, my dad was ill at the time, and I wrote a bit about my dad going to chemo. Came time for the chemo, and I sat my pop down, and we're in the garage, and I told him, I said, Pop, look, it's all taken care of. I got you into the best hospital in the city, all right? Don't ask me how, don't ask me why. Your name is on the top of that list. Now all I need you to do is walk through that door, and I want you to beat this thing down, you hear me? I had the stones to, not to pat myself on the back, but I wrote what I wanted to say. I brought the audience emotionally way down, and I don't think I could have done that joke if I was a younger comic, knowing what I needed to do for the emotional release I wanted to have in the joke.
So Pop, look at me. I got you the best shot we got at beating this. Yeah, I know, son. And I looked at that city hospital, I really did, but this is gonna be a 2-3 month deal, and where you gotta go, it's got all those stairs, and your mother don't climb the stairs that good no more, so that can't work for us. He's looking right down the barrel at it, and his priority is my mother can't climb those stairs no more. That's the same man made me shovel the driveway with a broken arm.
So I took the chance, I did it, and when it got released, it helped a great deal of people. And I got a call from Professor Eddie Freifeld, who taught at Yale Drama, Yale and NYU. He reached out to my manager and said, we want to license this bit as a teaching tool. And I got that call, and I went, free, take it, kidding? God bless you. So that bit, I will distinguish that bit because it went on to have a bigger life.
Wow, very cool. And that, yeah, that does take a lot of moxie, if you will, on stage to kind of have the balls to bring the down and then get them back again.
Yeah, let's be honest, Don. It's artistic courage. I'm not running into a fucking burning building.
Right. Right, but yeah, it's still, when you're on stage, And you know, and you take the risk to get serious or bring it the down, you know, the mood down when you
pull out quick because somebody wants to stay there.
Yeah, exactly. So
pull up on the stick.
Best comedy advice you ever got from a fellow comedian?
I will give you the best advice, life advice I got from a fellow artist. I think it was my acting coach. It was basically, it ain't fair and don't be late.
Awesome. Do you remember the very first time you did stand up and how did it go?
July 13th, 1988, Eastside Comedy Club, the one that was on Jericho Turnpike, was a Wednesday night, was an open mic night. Awesome. So the answer is yes.
And do you remember what you were wearing?
I remember I had a brand new pair of high top Chuck Taylors, black and white ones. I remember because I had them on my desk in New York. I had them up on the shelves, and for some reason I put candles in them because I didn't have shoe trees. So they were sitting on the shelf of my desk, and I used them as bookends. And my wife came in and went, "You're a grown man." And I went, "Well, she wasn't my wife then. She was my girlfriend." She goes, "You're a grown man." I go, "Those are my first sneakers." The meaning. She's like, "They smell like feet. They smell like feet and candles." And I think I'm pretty sure she got. I know what I donated them. Someone wrapped some silent auction, raffled them off. So that was it.
What is your best bomb story?
I was doing a gig. Corporate gigs are nice. Every comic knows corporate gigs, great money, but they're away games. Anytime you go to them, it's an away game. So you just put that in your head. So right. I always try and go up after the meal. You don't want them clanking forks and eating stuff. And they're corporate gigs. So they don't know what they're doing. So I got a gig to do. It was very early on in my career. And I got a gig at the for oncologists, for cancer doctors, at the Fountain Blue Hotel in Miami. Jackie Gleason's show came out of the Fountain Blue. The answer is yes, right?
Yeah.
So I went down. I did the gig. And big, big ballroom filled with people. The meal is over. They got two big screens up here and a podium in the middle. And there's a doctor up there. And the doctor mixed my intro in with his closing announcements. And there's two cells on these screens. There's a cell here, a cell here. The guy's at the podium. And he's like, "We want to thank Arthur for his generous donation to our foundation. Our comedian tonight is Adam Ferrara. And we have to be vigilant because there is no cure. Keep up the good work." And he walked out. Dead silence. Nobody knows who I am. I walk out. They're just staring at me. There's a mic stand. I grabbed the mic stand and I said, "Okay, my name's Adam Ferrara. I'm a comedian, but just to review." And I took the mic stand and I pointed at the two cells. I went, "Benign, malignant. Benign, malignant." Nothing. I guess I got it wrong. I guess those were the other ones. I have no idea. So nothing. So I had to dig out of that hole. And eventually, you know, I got out of it. But that was a long slog, baby.
That's tough, man.
Yeah.
What is the best part to you for being a stand-up comedian? What's your favorite thing about being a stand-up
comedian?
I like
the cash.
That's what I thought you were going to say.
I have a mortgage and a wife. She eats every day. No, the best part for me is... whether it's good or whether it's bad, I know it's what I should be doing. So that takes a lot of anxiety away because, you know, how are you going to deal with what is? Like, oh, what if I, there is no what if I, you're here, this is it, this is what you do, do it. So that's the best part of it is I found my place early and I'm grateful for it. However long it lasts is out of my control.